one, you've just seen their face, but whose name is it? On the big red book.
Tonight we're on a special mission to find someone who very kindly, and on more than one occasion, has saved Earth and the galaxy from unspeakable evil. Especially when you're chasing someone through space and time. He wasn't always a high flyer. For a while, he studied to become a monk. Then he realized his true vocation was acting. He was a success on stage and screen, but the good times didn't roll for long, and to make a living, he took a job as a laborer on a building site. But his bad luck was exterminated for good when he landed the role that made his name. So, who is he? These days, he's also a successful writer. And right now, he's here at Kingston-upon-Thames, signing copies of his latest book. Let's see if I can interest him in our plot.
Stop. Indicate objective location. Invisibility. Position.
From my past.
Yes, there's a lot of past to talk about, actually. I'm a book lover, pardon the intrusion, but I've got a book of my own, which has got your name on it, because it is entitled, Tom Baker, This Is Your Life.
What do you really look like?
You don't want to know, Marty. Believe me, you don't want to know.
Now, your latest role in the remake of Randall and Hopkirk's Deceased has teamed you with a comic taking his first straight acting job. A short speech now from your dear friend Jim Moyer, alias Vic Reeves.
Well, I'm here growing antlers in a luxurious country resort. Now, Tom, I remember we had a fantastic time filming Randall and Hopkirk, and I remember at about 5 or 6 o'clock every evening you said, Jim, I feel it's time for a gin and tonic. And on the final day, you presented me with your special gin and tonic, which was a bucket of gin, a bit of tonic, some lime, and ice. Delicious, so I haven't looked back since. Tom, have a fantastic evening, and I hope to join you once again very soon for more gin.
To bring Randall and Hopkirk back to life came from another of your funny friends, the fast show's Charlie Higson.
Hi, Charlie.
You're giving me the
contact. Charlie, tell us all about reincarnation, please.
Well, Vic Reeves there plays the dead detective Marty Hopkirk, and I felt when we were writing it that we needed someone who could teach him how to be a ghost, a sort of spirit guide. So we needed this supernatural mentor figure, sort of Obi-Wan Kenobi. And he had to be larger than life, a voice like God, and half mad.
Yeah.
So he's only ever one name on the list.
Charlie, thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
So to Act 1, Scene 1, Tom Baker, this is your life. You're born on January the 20th, 1934, at Oxford Street Maternity Hospital in Liverpool, yes. The first of three children for Mary Jane and Stuart. There was you, your sister Louisa, and baby John. Your father served with the Merchant Navy on board the Mauritania and Queen Elizabeth, rising from boy waiter to chief steward. And for a while, your family lived at your aunt's house. And your cousins, Michael and Billy, are more like brothers to you. Billy, you went to school together.
Yes, we went to St. Swithin's, which was an old farmhouse converted into three classrooms.
No, but it was good, though, wasn't it? Yes.
Yeah, we used to enjoy it.
We were confident about everything then, yes. And then there was God. you know, we gave him every chance. We were so devoted to him, yeah.
Because he and I were an item, as you know, for years.
Well, we'll come to that, right?
We'll still talk. You haven't got God here, have you?
Well, I don't know. Well, your father was away for 2 years during the war and survived no less than three torpedo attacks. That's because the Germans were getting personal.
Yes.
A bombing raid on Liverpool brings fresh adventures for you and your pals, and 60 years on, here is one of them, Frank Weston. So, Frank, you went on treasure hunts together.
Yes, we did. After the raid of the night before, we go down the shores, around the fields. We go everywhere, picking up pieces of shrapnel.
And two stones of German prisoners of war, yes. Incredible. A lot of Italians. We used to let the Italians stroke us because the Pope was Italian, yes.
Well, reminds me, you were both altar boys, weren't you?
Yes, we were. We served together, didn't we?
And, yes, we did.
So we had to learn Latin. And my mother, fortunately, was familiar with the Mass, and she could teach us Latin.
She did.
You come down, and you're a great scholar, weren't you?
Yeah, well, the mother taught me in Latin, yes.
And you've done so well, Tom. We're so proud of you from Liverpool, yes. We really are. We wish you luck and continue success.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
As a boy, you're keen on sports, particularly football and running,
yes.
And you encourage a school friend to get involved. Later, you go your separate ways, but when you become well-known, he writes to you, Nick Ryan.
Hello, Tom. I didn't even realise at first that you were Doctor Who, and when I found out, I went back home and I took an ice cream. You have to iron favourite. I used to play with him. I played football with him. I used to go running with him. You're kidding. So remember, I wrote to you. You sent a card back to my daughter Claire saying, I'm the best. Everything your dad said is true. Tonight I'm off to St. Lucia with my wife to celebrate our 3D wedding anniversary. Have a lovely evening. God bless you. Cheers, Tom.
In 1946, at the age of 12, you go to St. Matthew's Catholic School in Walton.
One day, a Christian brother comes to the school to talk about his life and work, and you were inspired, weren't you?
I was. I was then. He isn't, is he?
No, you can relax. We'll just tell the story.
Here I am.
So you decide to join. After initial instruction in Shropshire comes the big question, is the monastic life really for you? Now, you've written that when you were sent to the Maison Bon Secours, a monastery in Jersey, your happiness was complete. But obviously, it didn't last.
Well, that's the way it is with happiness, isn't it? You don't expect it to last. I was looking for another kind of happiness. I think one goes through lots of happinesses. This is my latest happiness. But I hope this one lasts. It was another happiness, you know, which was inevitably going to fail.
Well, leaving the Order might have disappointed the brothers, but you were more concerned about upsetting your mother, so you call on your cousin Billy for his support.
I
Billy,
did.
You remember that?
Yeah, the day that you came to our house, you remember?
Yeah.
And you were dressed in your black suit?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. You were crying, I think. I was. Mm. I was so distraught and afraid of hurting my mother. So in my grief, I went to my Auntie Louie and to Billy. That's right, sir. An amazing day. I never forget that.
Never. But your mother wanted you to be happy, I suppose.
Yes, of course she wanted me to be happy, yes. I mean, yes, she adored me. And I always wanted to be adored. Actually, I wanted to be worshipped, but...
Well, from the quiet contemplation of the monastery, you get a massive culture shock in 1955. Age 21, you're conscripted into the army. You're posted to a British military hospital in Germany as a medical orderly.
Yes.
And I've flown in from Australia to say thank you, Tom, for saving my life.
40 years on, from Adelaide, your army pal, Tony Maudsley.
Tony Maudsley, yes.
Tony, this sounds suitably dramatic.
I was the butt of a barracoon joke going really wrong. I'd hopped into bed, I was just about to go off to sleep, and about six guys out the billet got the end of my bed and picked it up. You remember that? We picked the bed up, I slid through the top rung of the bed, and my head was against the wall, and they were pushing to try and get the bed upright.
And I asked them to stop.
You didn't ask them to stop. You didn't ask them. I heard this thunderous roar coming down the barrack room there, and I heard you shouting, put him down, put him down!
Yeah.
And then they dropped the bed down, and that's when I saw you standing there, two fists up, all ready to go. Come on, you guys, one at a time. We're all together.
I didn't say one at a time. I said all together. Yeah, that sounds more preposterous.
But I'm here because of that, mate.
Of course you are.
Thank you, Tony, very much. Now, while you're in the army, you perform in a Christmas review and you're bitten by the bug. You're convinced the actor's life is for you.
Yes.
And after the army, you enroll at the Rose Bruford College of Speech and Drama at Sidcup in Kent.
Yes.
Whenever I think of you, Tom, I think of sausages.
Well, at the start, he was a student with you, Malcolm Tierney. Malcolm, sausages, I think you said.
Sausages, yes. I was in a play at the Royal Court, long hair, beard and everything, and I'd adopted a philosophy of frugalism and shunning worldly pleasures and so on. I was living out in Greenwich, and you hadn't got anywhere to live, and you were completely broke. And you were an absolutely model lodger. You know, you tidied up for me, you kept the place clean, and you never complained once about the sausages. Anyway, one night I come back, I do the potatoes, and I'm going to the sausages, and he said, now, bad news. Sausages are no longer with them. And I said, but oh, you mean you've eaten them? They said, no, they're off. They're off, they're buried, they're dead and buried. They probably died about a week ago. But I found that I'm going to have to tell you.
I'm so mortified by this. I gave up frugalism forever. And that's my story.
I'm so glad.
I joined you. Thank you, Malcolm. Thank you.
Yeah.
a newly qualified thespian, you're not a very busy one, although you do manage to find yourself a wife, Anna Wheatcroft.
Yes.
And you have two sons,
yes.
Daniel and Piers. But the marriage ends in 1967, mm-hmm. and you lose touch with the boys. Yes. 3 years ago, you flew with Sue to New Zealand to appear in a commercial. And we go to Auckland now to take up the story with your son, Piers.
Hello, Tom. It was here in January 97, I'm sure you remember, where we had one of the most bizarre meetings of our life. I walked into the restaurant, looking for a table, and who do I see but you there? Quite a shock for me, but nothing compared to the shock for you. I had to plan my strategy of how to introduce myself to you. I hadn't seen you for so many years. I had a word with the waiter, asked him if I could take care of your tab, of which I did, and therefore you'd have to come to the bar and inquire about who had paid this tab, of which of course you did. Now, there was a semblance of recognition you had in your eye, but I thought I could help you along the way, so I introduced myself to you. My name's Baker, I said. Piers Baker. Well, the look on your face, really quite fantastic. A great reunion we had, too. I'm delighted you're being honoured this evening, and delighted that we're back in touch.
The Baker voice, that must have been quite unnerving for you.
He was, yes. I looked at him and I said, I think I should, is your name Morgan or something? He said, no, my name's Baker, Piers Baker. I'm your son. That was a killer.
Yeah.
Naturally, I said, how do you do? I'd introduced him to his stepmother.
Well, back to the plot and the 1960s. Your life isn't exactly swinging. And then you write and you perform your own comedy fringe show and impress a talent spotter from the National Theatre.
Yes.
You audition for Laurence Olivier and you join the company, playing a variety of roles, including a very convincing force in The Travails of Sancho Panza. But then Olivier suggests you for a part in a new film about the doomed Russian Tsar Nicholas and his family. One night, the Hollywood producer, Sam Spiegel, comes to see you on stage. And that's how you become Rasputin, the Mad Monk.
I don't like St. Petersburg. It makes me drink too much. And when I drink, the women come. The women here are worse than the peasants in my village. No restraint. Is Matushka angry with me?
She won't admit you even take a drink, much less. No. She believes in you completely.
She is a saint.
Playing Tsar Nicholas in that film, Michael Jason.
Yes.
Nicholas and Alexandra, and Rasputin was a terrific character.
Well, he was absolutely perfect casting because Tom had been a monk and he was mad, so he played a mad monk. And he did get the Golden Globe nomination for Best Newcomer. We've marched together for 30 years, and you're not mad, you're a glorious eccentric. And your boundless generosity to me and my family, I can't repay it. I cherish your friendship.
Oh, good.
God bless you.
Next, you appear in Italian director Pier Paolo Pasolini's film of the Canterbury Tales, and then disappointingly work dries up. For a while, you teach English to foreign students, but by 1973, you're hard up and fed up. After that, you take on a different kind of toil, labouring on a building site.
Yes.
And there was no time for play acting with us, Tom.
With his brother John, your boss, Arthur Cordes.
Yes.
You hired Tom as a builder's mate.
Well, yes, a general labourer. He wasn't a bad lad either.
Did he specialise in anything?
He liked the tango. He was a great tango man.
Yes.
He liked a tango.
He means a drill.
And I don't know if the Royal Ballet ever realise what they were missing.
Not anymore. Thank you very much, Julia. In a Royal Shakespeare production of William Russell's Educating Rita, you played the hard-drinking professor.
Yes.
Rita was Kate Fitzgerald.
Yes.
Kate, a tailor-made part for Tom.
Well, yes, it was, and we had a good few drinks on the way, didn't we, Tom? But my overriding memory is of a very big man with an even bigger heart. And there was one particular time in air, and we were at the end of a long, arduous tour, and it was the last day of the week we'd done eight performances, and my father had taken the opportunity of going to Glasgow to pick up a lady who'd been very kind to him when he'd been billeted there during the war, and bring her to air to see the show. But they couldn't get back to the problems with the train system. And Tom immediately gave up his hotel room so she could have somewhere comfortable to spend the night.
The next year, you're back on the box playing a priest in Fay Weldon's The Life and Loves of a She-Devil,
yeah,
adapted for the screen by your friend Ted Whitehead. Another TV hit is Medic, with Dinah Stapp, Hugh Quashie,
yeah,
and someone who is now a member of the lovable royal family, Sue Johnson.
Hi, Tom. Congratulations. Well, I think this is a really lovely thing for you, and it's a lovely thing for me, because I can get a word in without you interrupting me. Tom, I miss working with you. We had such fun on Medic. You made me laugh so much. You're a fountain of joy and knowledge, and I miss you very much. And we've still got that date, remember, to go and watch Liverpool at Anfield. Don't forget. Have a great time, and I hope to see you soon. Bye-bye.
And here's another voice from Memory Lane. Well, Coronation Street, actually.
What did you say your name was, Inspector?
Gould? He was Derek Wilson, he is.
Peter Baldwin, yeah.
An
Inspector Calls, yes, we played at the Westminster Theatre, remember,
yeah,
13 years ago?
Yeah.
Tom was a majestic inspector, and I was a less than majestic Arthur Burling, the head of the family. But I think we worked together well on stage, Tom, didn't we?
I think so, we got lots of laughs,
I think. Yes, I don't think we were intended to, but I giggled a lot.
Yeah.
I don't think you appreciate it. But there is one other reason I have to remember that production. Towards the end of the run, my wife went into hospital with cancer, you remember? She died a few weeks later, and it was very difficult going on stage every night, but your kindness, your understanding, your thoughtfulness was immeasurable. I remember coming back from the hospital one day to the theatre, and there was a lot of champagne in the fridge, and I said, Tom, this is not a time for celebration, and you said, champagne is not only for celebration, it is for friendship, and I've never forgotten that. Thank you very much.
The last 2 years have unleashed another of your talents, writing. Today I surprised you while you were publicising your book, The Boy Who Kicked Pigs, to follow up to the success of your 1997 autobiography, Who on Earth is Tom Baker, which you dedicated to Sue. In the introduction, you recount the reunion with your long-lost son. Earlier, we heard how his work as a horticulturalist keeps him busy in New Zealand.
However, not today.
From Auckland, your son Piers.
Next Saturday, 8:55, here on BBC One.